Hello, dear viewers. Welcome to my channel, Science to Technology. In today's show, Future Friday, we're going to talk about black holes. So let's dive right into it. Well, first, you have to understand this. In this universe, many things are controlled by density. Now, in density-wise, stars themselves are not very dense. Why? Because they are plasma. So they are not that dense. However, you go to their core, at that point, they are dense. Now you go to neutron stars, they are ludicrously dense. Now, here's the tip. That's very dense because most of the atoms are like 99.99% empty space. And neutron stars do not have like electron cloud floating around. They just have neutrons filled up that empty space. So it's on a completely different volume. Like one spoon is like a, you know, equivalent weight of like a whole planet. So it's on a different level. Now, here's the black hole is on a whole another level. It's like it bends space-time. Now, everything that has mass bends space-time. Heck, even my hands bend space-time, but it's not too much. You can't even detect it. But moon, a little bit. Our planet, a little bit. Sun, yeah, but we started to use our equipment to detect gravitational bending because of that, gravitational lensing. So, okay, that's now we are talking. How about black hole? Now, here's the it does not bend it. It breaks it. Basically, it takes the bending to a point. And that should not happen. Like all the bending is supposed to be a curve. That's the whole thing. That's why you can orbit other things. Like this puppy takes it on hold, but it's like, nope, I'm gonna bend it. And what happens at that point? We call it singularity. Every single law of physics just goes YOLO at that point. It's like, bro, I don't even care. So that's the whole point. That's why nothing can escape here, because everything, even a neutron star, has escape velocity. This puppy collapses to such a point where even light speed is not fast enough. So if you fire a torch from bottom of it, yeah, it's like, nope, nope. You can't do anything. Now again, you can orbit it if you are far enough, like before you fall into the well. If you are there, like basically you are above outside of event horizon, you are safe, quote unquote. At that point, it's more or less like a star. But if you come close to that, it breaks every single known law of physics, so to say. And it does not emit light, even though it can absorb insane amount of thing, as in like it can eat up entire gas cloud, it can end up eating an entire star itself, it will still not emit light. It's not like you have a planet which does not emit light but reflects light of a sun or a star. This does not do that. It's like it just, you shine a torch light into it, it's like it's not even there. So the sole reason we can see it, like sometimes how you see in movie Interstellar, is just they are seeing the accretion disk, or sometimes even you are seeing a naked basically black hole. The sole reason you can see that at that point would be because of the gravitational lensing that it would be causing, not because it's emitting light. It's flat out, it's just a hole. So that's the whole point. It does not bend space-time, it breaks it. It's like takes the bending and makes it into a point. Now, how the heck it's created is like a very weird thing. It's like, how the heck something like that happens? Well, you start with a thing that has most gravity, massive stars. Basically, stars that are like so huge that make our basically sun look like a little toy. So stars, those are huge. What do they are actually doing? Like, what are they actually doing in your day-to-day life? They are basically fighting or trying to balance two forces, force of gravity and force of fusion. Basically, fusion is pushing gravity and holding it at bay. It's like, okay, everything is at equilibrium, everything is stable. Now, fusion, it's an energy-driven process. Basically, you need fuel to convert into energy. Over time, it runs out. Now, again, depending on your size, depending on your fuel reserves, it could take a few million years, give or take, but it will run out. Now, gravity is a passive kind of system. It does not care. It is going to be there like 1 year from now or 1 trillion years from now. It does not care. As long as you have mass, gravity would be there. So fusion runs out. Now gravity starts to go like, yay, we won, and it starts to collapse it. Now because it's collapsing, it's pouring so much energy into one single point, it goes boom. Now that boom is known as supernova. Now this boom is so powerful because you have to understand it, creating matter, basically every element you see in the periodic table, is ludicrously difficult. Like heck, we are having hard time taking hydrogen and fusing it into helium. Stars do that on a regular basis, and even then only supermassive stars can take it down to very higher levels. Basically they can take let's say a lot of helium, make it into carbon, then take helium plus carbon and then make it into oxygen. They can keep doing down till iron. Now find the iron in the periodic table. Everything above it, it can be done in a star. Now here's the where the hell the rest of the elements come, that only comes in one event, supernova or hypernova. Basically you have to go even more YOLO than this. That's the only event where you can create something that you know, basically heavy, so to say. Anything above number 26. So supernova is greater. Now at the core, still something will remain because again, gravity won. So something generally remains in the core. Now, depending on how heavy the core is, it could be in a stable state where it's like either a neutron star, white dwarf or something like that. Or sometimes that core could, because of the event, basically the collapsing event itself, could start to collapse in itself. Basically, it's ludicrously dense and it crosses that threshold to become what the hell density, and then it becomes a black hole. Basically, you are the core, the stellar remaining of a star, a supermassive star, at like almost at a border where it's like, okay, I'm stable, I'm not stable. Now, that's why people will always specify supermassive hole can become a basically black hole. It's not guaranteed because, again, this event itself could blow apart the core. Things of that nature could happen. So if it collapses, it becomes a black hole. Basically, density goes from ludicrously high to infinity. So black hole mathematically is described in such a way that where it's like, okay, it has infinite density but zero volume. There is no size to it. It's just a point in space. There is no dimension to it. There is no length, width, or breadth. And everything you see, basically the singularity, that's the thing you can measure. Basically, when you say, oh, 3 kilometers wide or 50 kilometers wide, what are you describing? You are describing the singularity. You cannot describe the black hole, actual black hole, because that's a point, dimensionless. So that's how it happens. Basically, a star goes boom, and depending on the situation, it can collapse on itself to a, such a point where it basically breaks every single law of physics that we know of. Now, okay, you may think, okay, black hole is like a star, and it acts like a star. Basically, if you replace our sun with a black hole, we're gonna be okay in terms of gravity-wise. Basically, gravity will be the same. We will keep orbiting. It does not have that, like, you know, movie magic where it's gonna suck everything. That's not gonna happen. However, it's not radiating energy away. So what happens to it? Basically, again, if sun was replaced, we will freeze to death. But what will happen in a normal scenario? So black hole, if it's not radiating energy away, that means it should be infinitely long-lived. Basically, stars live very long time, but they have a lifespan. We know, we have seen what happens when they go boom. What about black holes? Now, this is why Stephen Hawking is so popular. He figured this out. Like, he cracked the code, basically. Black holes are not infinite. They will die out, same as a star. Now, the sole reason they will do that is called Hawking radiation. I mean, his honor, that's why I specified. Now, black hole, quote-unquote, evaporates away. They are not having nuclear fusion and fusion because, again, laws of physics does not work. But somehow they are losing their mass. How the heck that happens? That happens because when you take a vacuum, you take cleanest vacuum, what the heck you have there? Well, you will say vacuum. Technically true in classical physics, but yes, the moment you go into quantum physics, you have virtual particles. These particles are generally created in pairs, they go apart and they collapse, and nobody knows that it even happened. This many times people classify as like zero point energy. So this is a normal thing, this is something we know, this is something we have tested, and it's a known thing, it's an absolutely known thing. So you have virtual pairs that are created and collapse, and then nobody knows about it. However, at the edge of a black hole, basically at the horizon point, there is a probability, if you have a basically virtual particle that is created, it will create two parts, basically one positive, one negative. Sometimes one of them will end up in the wrong place in the horizon, and voila, it's gone, permanently gone. But the other particle, because it will be in different direction, different vector, it will keep continuing, and it will go from virtual particle to real particle, and voila, mass is lost. Basically, black hole will start losing its energy. Energy, mass, same, you know, tomato and tomato. And that's why black holes, even though they have ludicrously long lifespan, they have a finite lifespan. They are not like infinite. They have finite lifespan. Now, in this scenario, in terms of black hole, basically black hole are invert of stars. In stars, the bigger you are, the smaller lifespan you're going to get. Here it's inverted. So if you are small, let's say very small, like say for some reason our sun goes boom and somehow manages to create a black hole, the black hole will be like lived for a few minutes. It will not live for decades. And decades, or even you know, millions of years. That's not going to happen. But when you're talking about something super massive, as in like, you know, size of our solar system, yeah, it's going to live for more or less one Google year. Now, what the hell is one Google year? One with 100 zeros. So yeah, that's a ludicrous amount of time. This is what Stephen Hawking figured it out, is basically what happens to an actual black hole. So we originally used to think that's the end game and it will remain there forever, but no, it also evaporates. And that creates a paradox, because on a quantum level, that should not be possible. You should not be able to like take a data of something and just, you know, destroy it. That's what we call information paradox. Again, that's the current working hypothesis. We are trying to figure that part out. But this part is known. This part we have tested and this works. So what about the first picture? This photograph has you know, captured all the internet's imagination, and you must have heard it was made on Event Horizon Telescope. Now here's the deal. There is no single telescope that is big enough to capture this, because this is, while though it's a supermassive black hole, while it's huge, physically huge, it's so far away from us that it's like tiny. It's like super duper tiny. Basically, even Hubble telescope cannot see it properly. So it's very tiny. So we started to use radio telescope. Now, using radio waves, we have this some luxury known as phased array. Basically, you can have multiple independent radios and they can act as a virtual radio, one huge radio. Now, phased array technology is nothing new. We has to use this in World War II during development of early ICBMs. They were like, you know, ICBM guidance systems, detection system and all that jazz. That this is the current technology we're gonna use in our 5G towers. That's why they have like multiple hundreds of small antennas, and electrically they're gonna phase their signal, basically where to aim, where to focus. So we took the same principle, took it on a whole different level, basically made it on a whole global level. Basically every radio telescope that could have been commandeered for this project was commandeered for this project, and they started to collect data utilizing advanced mathematics and radio geometry. We started to focus on Messier 87, basically this supermassive black hole, and we captured this photograph. Now you see, this is compilation. Basically before this, each of the basically radio telescope were acting as a virtual one. So if you have taken data from one of them, it's not that you will get a low resolution photo, you will not get any photo. So that's why they generally had like hard drives even from as far as Antarctica, left basically in a plane, because again they did not have fiber optic there. So they used basically hard drive to transfer the data into one central location, and then they process it, and this is the image. It's huge, but super far, so it's very small. Now you might be like, why don't we focus on basically supermassive black hole that is our backyard, center of our own galaxy? They will be working on that. They're supposed to release that photograph this year, but again, the world ended in 2020, so the project has been delayed to 2021. Let's see what happens after that point. This was like a kind of trial run, and then we're gonna get more high resolution photographs. So what is this supermassive one? I specified black holes have like inverse relationship with their lifespan. Basically, the bigger they are, the longer they're gonna live, because that evaporation rate will slow down. So generally these big ones, how they are created? Most of the time they have supermassive stars that create them, that creates hypernova to do that. And other times a black hole is there and it keeps absorbing other things. Basically, let's say it collapsed an entire gas cloud, another star, planets, things. If things keep falling on it, it will keep growing. At certain point it will reach a size where it's like, dude, I'm chill. At this point it's like it's a self-degradation lifespan would be so slow that it does not need to gobble up another planet or another gas cloud for a few million years. So at some point it reaches a lifespan where it's like, bro, I'm chill, like I'm good, I'm gonna live for a very long time. So whenever you see something super huge, like let's say a galaxy, something has to bind it, something at the center has to bind it. What the heck was it? This is the point of supermassive black hole. Now we're like, why the heck it's bright? If there is a freaking black hole there, shouldn't this place be black? I specified anything that falls light onto it, basically you cannot shine light on it, but imagine this way, this is a black hole, I come in between. So if I'm talking on this side, basically light I'm firing onto the screen will not come back. But if I'm firing right side, basically my backside, you will see it clearly without any issue. That's how a supermassive black hole is visible to us, because every star that is orbiting it, the star face that is facing the black hole, that light is gone. But star face that is facing outwards, you will see that. And because so many huge stars are, you know, orbiting this puppy, it's becoming visible. That's why it glows so bright. And we have actual animations from this with actual telescopes, X-ray telescopes, and we can see through this, like it's flinging around stars. Like there are huge, huge stars. They will make our sun look like a little bit toy. And those are like, you know, orbiting around without, like, who cares. So supermassive black holes are there, present in almost every galaxy's center, unless it's a very tiny galaxy. Generally all big galaxies, we know for a fact that they have a center, and in the center there is a supermassive black hole that is handling everything, so to say. And because of their super large size, they are stable, so to say. So the more bigger they get, the more stable they become, and the longer lived they get. So they can literally outlive their own galaxy itself. So this is the focus of supermassive one. Now what about the things that is happening inside the galaxy, basically inside the black hole? One thing you have to understand, we know what black hole does, we know how it does gravitational lensing. I mean, like, we can observe it, we can analyze it, we can predict it, and all those things work. We know how it handles other star, how things are orbiting. Everything about that is known, we know for a fact, we have measured it. Here's it. How the heck it does that, we have no clue. It's like, nope, done. Because technically that's the whole problem with general relativity and quantum physics. Both of them are known physics, both of them are absolutely correct. We make predictions based on them and they work out in real life. So it's a known thing, it's a real thing. But somehow a black hole somehow manages to take that and collapse it into a central point. Basically, to solve that, we need some way to for general relativity and quantum physics to make a baby, which we will call a theory of everything. That's what people are talking about, because at that point of singularity, mathematics do not make sense. It's like goes YOLO. It's like, I don't care. So we do not know what happens in there. Like, heck, for all intents and purposes, there could be a tesseract inside it. Again, likelihood is very low, but you get the idea. Like, we do not know what happens at that point. So anybody tells you the effect of a black hole, how it affects the surroundings, how it becomes into a, like, you know, a giant and all that, we know all that. But the moment somebody starts to describe what's happening inside, that's a hypothetical scenario right now. We do not know at this point in time. We need another Stephen Hawking. Like, once Stephen Hawking figured out, like, how the heck it lives, somebody has to go deeper inside. Basically, Stephen Hawking at the same level as Newton was. He figured out gravity, but he did not know what was causing gravity. Einstein comes along and figured out what is gravity actually is. So Stephen Hawking did the same thing, and we are waiting for someone else, another genius who can come along. It's like, okay, this is what's happening inside it, because singularity right now does not make sense. It's like, what the hell? And there is a very good chance, if we can truly figure it out, there is a good chance we will reach theory of everything, because at that point, that's our biggest stumbling block. How the heck basically Newtonian physics, large scale physics, will marry the small scale one, like quantum physics. So a lot of unknown. So this was my presentation on black holes. I hope you liked it, learn from it. In that case, please click the like button, share it amongst your friends. That will help me a lot. If you didn't like it, didn't enjoy it, I urge you to press dislike, press it twice to show me your disappointment. Please leave a comment, because I try to reply to all of them. Subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free, and as always, thanks for watching.